former Trump campaign chairman Paul Manafort to influence Mr. Trump. This new detail expands on a story that CNN broke last week. It comes on the heels of former CIA Director John Brennan's testimony yesterday about multiple contacts between the Trump campaign and Russians and the concerns they raised for him. Now, the backdrop for all of this, obviously, is the federal investigation into possible collusion between the Trump campaign and Russia. Whether collusion occurred, that is still an open question. Just to be clear, though, there is no dispute among the intelligence community that Russia was behind the election hacking. They flat out said so under oath at a recent Senate hearing. But despite the certainty of the nation's top intelligence chiefs, conspiracy theorists are working hard to pin the blame on a young DNC staffer who was murdered last July. Now, there's zero evidence, but that has not stopped them, though in the last 48 hours, one of the conspiracy's most high-profile and vocal proponents has backed off, at least for now. Tom Foreman reports on the anatomy of a conspiracy theory.
I heard two gunshots the other night.
D.C. police have spent months investigating the murder of 27-year-old Seth Rich, and they believe it was a botched robbery that happened as he walked home late at night. The unsuccessful hunt for his killer, a frustration for them and the victim's family.
We will find his murderer.
But former Republican Speaker of the House Newt Gingrich claimed over the weekend, with no evidence, that the case may be about something more sinister.
This young man who worked for the Democratic National Committee, who apparently was assassinated at 4 in the morning, having given WikiLeaks something like 53,000 emails.
It was an explosive charge, a conspiracy involving WikiLeaks, the Democratic National Committee, and assassination. One big problem, though, it's not true. In fact, the whole crazy theory had already been debunked by CNN and other news organizations when Gingrich made the claim. But Gingrich wasn't alone. He had only joined a flood of right-wing conspiracy theorists pushing the notion.
There's a possibility this is a guy who provided two WikiLeaks, all those DNC emails.
Then he was shot in the back.
And with no proof, they even suggested the young murder victim may be to blame, claiming he was so angry at his own party for some reason that he handed over the emails to get even.
If it was true that Seth Rich gave WikiLeaks the DNC emails, wouldn't that blow the whole Russia collusion narrative that the media has been pushing out of the water?
Where did these wild theories come from? From veiled hints from fugitive WikiLeaks founder Julian Assange, from a FoxNews.com story citing an unnamed alleged federal source, and from this private detective who says he's never seen the emails, never seen Rich's computer, yet...
It's very consistent for a person with my experience to begin to think, well, perhaps there were some email communications between Seth and WikiLeaks.
The U.S. government invests a lot of money in spy clouds.
In yet another bizarre twist, the notorious hacker known as Kim.com, seen here in an interview with Russian state TV, claims he has the evidence. Why won't he produce it? He's fighting extradition to the U.S. for conspiracy, racketeering, and money laundering. But in a statement on his website said, if my evidence is required to be given, I would need a guarantee from Special Counsel Mueller on behalf of the United States of safe passage from New Zealand to the United States and back. Seth Rich's family sent a cease and desist letter to the private detective and yesterday pleaded in a statement to Sean Hannity that read in part, it is a travesty that you would prompt false conspiracy theories and other people's agendas rather than work with the family to learn the truth. With that, the story seemed to finally lose one of its biggest champions.
Out of respect for the family's wishes for now, I am not discussing this matter at this time.
Even so, today, the story lives on.
There's still some question as to whether the intrusion at the DNC server was an insider job or whether or not it was the Russians.
Well, no, what evidence? I'm sorry. The insider job, what are you referring to here? Because I hope it's not this information that Fox News just refused to be reporting.
Well, again, there's stuff circulating on the Internet.
Tom Foreman, CNN.
There is stuff circulating on the Internet. Elected official representing us. It's the top of the hour, bringing you breaking news from the campaign trail. The alleged assault of a reporter by one of the candidates in what could be a bellwether special election for Montana. Greg Gianforte, the Republican hopeful in Montana, allegedly body slamming The Guardian's Ben Jacobs. That's according to Ben Jacobs. Here's the audio posted by The Guardian.
to the CBO score, because you know you were waiting to make your decision about healthcare until you saw the bill and it just came out.
And what we'll talk to you about that later.
Yeah, but there's not going to be time. I'm just curious if you have
to speak with Shane, please.
But you don't have
sick and tired of you guys. The last time you came in here, you did the same thing. Get the hell out of here. Get the hell out of here. The last guy did the same thing. You were the guardian?
Yes, and you just broke my glasses.
The last guy did the same damn thing.
You just body slammed me and broke my glasses.
Get the hell out of here.
You'd like me to get the hot up here, I'd also like to call the police. Can I get you guys' names?
Hey, you gotta leave.
He just body slammed me.
Well, just moments ago, the candidate spokesman issued a statement. It reads, quote, tonight, as Greg was giving a separate interview in a private office, the Guardian's Ben Jacobs entered the office without permission, aggressively shoved a recorder in Greg's face, and began asking badgering questions. Jacobs was asked to leave. You heard the questions he was asking about the Congressional Budget Office score. The statement continues, quote, after asking Jacobs to lower the recorder, Jacobs declined. Greg then attempted to grab the phone that was pushed in his face. Jacobs grabbed Greg's wrist and spun away from Greg, pushing them both to the ground. The statement concludes, it's unfortunate that this aggressive behavior from a liberal journalist created this scene at our campaign volunteer barbecue. CNN's Kyung La is in Montana. She joins us now. You interviewed the candidate just a few hours before this confirmation. How did he seem to you? And this whole issue of the Congressional Budget Office thing, the reason it's timely is because he had resisted making a public declaration about it until the CBO released their score. That's what the reporter was asking about.
And I actually asked him the exact same question. I interviewed Mr. Gianforte about 3 hours prior to this confrontation with Ben Jacobs, that print reporter. I met with him, spent some time with him. He answered several questions. He did talk about health care. He said that he needed to study the CBO score. He needed to look at the further details. This is a difficult dance for him, but he seemed very willing to talk about it. I'd interviewed him about a month prior as well, Anderson, and his demeanor seemed very similar today as it was a month ago. I mean, certainly he is under pressure. It is the day before the special election. His campaign is on overdrive. He is trying to hit as many spots as possible. So that is certainly wearing on him. But he didn't seem any different than he was a month ago. His demeanor, very similar. And you heard his voice, his elevated voice. That was definitely his voice. I mean, he has a very distinctive, loud voice. That was certainly him on that audio recording. But as far as whether or not he seemed more aggressive or any different, he didn't seem that way to me, Anderson.
We should also point out the Guardian had previously published an article that basically stated that this candidate held, I think, more than $100,000 or something in investments in two index funds that were, I guess, heavily invested in Russia or Russian index funds. And I guess did not like that article. You're about to interview the Democratic candidate, Rob Quist. He's certainly the underdog in this race. How are they responding to this incident?
I went in and just tried to speak to his press person, and she said that they were going to refrain from commenting on this right now. They really want to just see this play out on the national level. Here in Montana, they don't think it's beneficial at all to have this sort of thing come in on the local level. We have gotten a statement from the DCCC, the National Democrats, the campaign arm of House Democrats, and what the DCCC is saying is that Gianforte needs to pull out of this race. Certainly, we're not getting any indication that's going to be happening. But Rob Quist is expected to arrive here shortly. He will be meeting with campaign supporters in his very last campaign event before the special election, before polls open at 7 a.m. Montana time. And, you know, from the indication I got from his campaign, he's just going to try to get through the day, try to be pleasant, try to get Montana people to vote for him on local state issues.
Yeah. It's interesting that in the statement they put out, they said that this was a liberal reporter. I mean, that's clearly not an accident that they inserted that into their statement. Kyung, thanks very much. A short time ago, we spoke by phone to BuzzFeed's Alexis Levinson, who was standing outside the room, had a partial view, saw some feet fly through the air. Here's what she said. Alexis Levinson, a reporter for BuzzFeed, who was outside the room, she joins us now by phone. So, Alexis, you were outside of this room. What did you see or hear?
So, this was the campaign meet and greet at Gianforte's campaign headquarters in Bozeman, and there was sort of a main room where a lot of volunteers were making phone calls, where all of us were standing around kind of waiting for a campaign event. There was a side room where a TV crew, I guess a local TV crew, was set up to do an interview. John Forte went in there. The door was half open. Ben walked in to kind of listen in. So I had a kind of half view. All of a sudden, I heard giant crash, saw Ben's feet fly in the air.
So I just want to quickly read the statement from the campaign, and then I want to play you the audio again, just to so you can see if you think it jives. Tonight, as Greg was giving a separate interview in a private office, the Guardian's Ben Jacobs entered the office without permission, aggressively shoved a recorder in Greg's face, began asking badgering questions. So you hear the questions, you're going to hear the questions asked there about the Congressional Budget Office. Jacobs was asked to leave. That certainly seemed to happen, that they basically were trying to brush him off. After asking Jacobs to lower the recorder, Jacobs declined. I'm not sure if I heard that, but we'll listen again to see if we hear that. Greg then attempted to grab the phone that was pushed in his face. Jacobs grabbed Greg's wrist and spun away from Greg, pushing them both to the ground. It's unfortunate this aggressive behavior from a liberal journalist created the scene at our campaign volunteer barbecue. So let's just listen to that sound again.
Into the CBO score, because you know you were waiting to make your decision about health care until you saw the bill and it just came out. And what
we'll talk to you about that later.
Yeah, but there's not going to be time. I'm just curious if you have
to
react
speak
right
with
now.
Shane, please.
But you don't.
I'm sick and tired of you guys. The last time you came in here, you did the same thing. Get the hell out of here. Get the hell out of here. The last guy did the same thing. You were the guardian?
Yes, and you just broke my glasses.
The last guy did the same damn thing.
You just body slammed me and broke my glasses.
Get the hell out of here.
You'd like me to get the hot dog, I'd also like to call the police. Can I get you guys' names?
Hey, you gotta...
He just body slammed me.
So just you just heard that in the statement. It says, after asking Jacobs to lower the recorder, Jacobs declined. I didn't hear any audio of that. I don't know if anybody else at home did, but I don't think you did. Greg then attempted to grab the phone that maybe happened. That was pushed in his face. Jacobs grabbed Greg's wrist and spun away from Greg, pushing them both to the ground. Obviously, there's no video. If they both ended up on the ground, it didn't sound like it. But perspective now from our political panel, Gloria Borger, Kirsten Powers, and Matt Nussbaum. Kirsten, I mean, in the statement, how does it jive with what you heard?
It doesn't sound the same. I also, like you said, it doesn't sound like both people fell to the ground. And the reporter is saying quite clearly, you body slammed me, and nobody's disputing it, right? So it's not like somebody's saying, like, what? I didn't body slam you. That's not what happened. They're not disputing it. I will say that if the reporter forced their way into an office, that's inappropriate. That said, the response to that is never physical violence. And I don't think that what the reporter was doing was overly aggressive questioning. It was asking a couple questions that seemed pretty reasonable and should be answered. And so the rage that kind of came back seemed a little disproportionate to what was actually happening.
Matt, to you, what did it sound like?
Well, yeah, I didn't really see how the statement and that audio we heard added up at all. Like you said, that questioning was not aggressive. He asked about the CBO score and then tried to follow up when he was brushed off. It didn't sound like there was any sort of scuffle. It sounded like he was attacked. Like you said, he immediately said, you body slammed me. That's not something you just come up with off the top of your head that you just make up. And I'll just say, the statement tries to politicize it right away, calling him a liberal reporter. Of course, he's not. He's a well-respected reporter for a well-respected outlet. But this should not be a partisan thing. On the Hill, Republicans and Democrats are interviewed by us reporters constantly with our phones and recorders in their faces. I have never seen anyone react remotely like that.
Gloria, I mean, it is, to Matt's point, inserting liberal in there,
sure.
Clearly, you know, there's a reason they do that.
Well, there is a reason, and he's running for Congress, and to call somebody a liberal whom you've just body slammed is probably one of the best ways to get out of it, I would presume, if there is any way to get out of it. Look, he is a candidate who has embraced Donald Trump wholeheartedly, and that means that he's embraced his health care package. And the question was about the CBO score, and which showed that 23 million people will not have health care. That's not a good question for him. His opponent, Rob Quist, who, by the way, is an underdog, and I would argue still remains an underdog in this race, has embraced Barack Obama's Affordable Care Act. So health care is kind of a hot button here, which is why the reporter was asking the question about it. It was a natural question to ask. And I think that in the last hours of a race, with this score coming out, you had a candidate who, for whatever reason, had no answer to that question. And the candidate should have had an answer to that question.
Kirsten, you raised this point earlier of a kind of the environment now of, you know, this antipathy toward reporters and this sort of license to just act out on it, I guess, that some people may feel.
Well, I think that, and I think the fact that they put liberal journalists in the statement just underscores that point, that there's something almost in the eyes of some Trump supporters that so-called liberal journalist, which is anybody who's not a conservative, who's not Sean Hannity, basically, right, you know, is a liberal journalist, are somehow like subhuman or something. You know, it's not, and I've been doing this for a long time, and I've, look, there's always been this sort of sense of people, maybe conservatives, feeling that journalists are a little too liberal, but it's never been the way it is now, where there is just such anger and hostility and rage that is directed at journalists, and that flows from Donald Trump. Right. I mean, it's a straight line.
If this was some Democratic candidate doing this to a conservative reporter, it would be the exact same. I mean, it would be as inappropriate.
It would be totally, of course. We would be saying the exact same thing. We would not be defending.
The story is not the politics of either side. It's the fact that this is a candidate.
Yeah, but I can almost guarantee you that there are going to be people, conservatives, that come out and defend what he did. I can almost guarantee it.
And, you know, this at this point in the election, with little time left, it's all about getting out your voters. And so there, you know, Montana is, Trump won by 20 points, but it's kind of quirky. And it's a quirky state. It has a Democratic governor, has a Democratic senator. And so if you're trying to figure out a way to turn this around, if you're Jim Forte and you're trying to turn it around, you're going to turn it into some liberal journalist. And I gave him what he deserved, which is, of course, ridiculous. But that's the best spin he could put on it. And it may motivate some of his people to come out and vote.
Yeah.
And Quist is trying to get his voters out there, and it could motivate his. You know, you never know what happens in the last hours of a campaign.
Matthew, do you want to say?
Well, I mean, there's nothing normal about this, even with the rhetoric being as charged as it is against reporters. You know, we've all had tough interviews. We're used to being booed at rallies and having candidates berate us. That's part of I guess the back and forth. It is more charged now, but this sort of physical altercation is the next level. For all Donald Trump has said about reporters, I think to tie these two things together is a little unfair, because this is really just so out of the norm. And I will say, I don't see any way this helps the case.
It sounds like it's somebody going from 0 to 60, you know, somebody like bursting out in anger. Anyway, we're going to leave it there. We'll obviously be interested in talking to the reporter and obviously the candidate as well. More breaking news. CNN has learned about something Attorney General Jeff Sessions failed to mention during his security vetting, namely contacts with a top Russian diplomat and suspect intelligence figure Sergei Kislyak. That same Sergei Kislyak we all know the name of by now. Mano Raju has the latest, joins us once again. So what have you learned on this?
Anderson, tonight the Justice Department is acknowledging that Attorney General Jeff Sessions did not disclose these meetings he had last year with Russian officials when he applied for his security clearance. Now, this is the latest example of Sessions not listing contacts he had with Russian officials. Remember earlier this year, he endured sharp criticism from Democrats after it was revealed that he did not disclose these same contacts with the Russian ambassador Sergei Kislyak during his Senate confirmation hearings. Now, Sessions met with Kislyak at least two times last year, including at the Republican National Convention, and he did not note those interactions on this form, which actually requires them to list any contact he or his family had with a foreign government or its representative over the past 7 years. And you'll remember, Anderson, that Sessions failed to disclose those meetings during those proceedings that led to Sessions recusing himself from all matters related to the Russia investigation.
So how is the Justice Department responding to this tonight?
Well, tonight the Justice Department says that Sessions met with hundreds of thousands, if not thousands, of foreign dignitaries, and they said they were advised by an FBI investigator not to list those meetings, given that he is a sitting senator. But I can tell you, Anderson, that not everyone agrees with that interpretation. One legal expert who we quoted in this story says that he has advised other lawmakers to fully disclose all foreign government contacts, even if it was done in an official capacity. And tonight, some Republicans are even saying that given all the questions over Russia, perhaps he should have disclosed even more than he did earlier this year.
So just to be clear, though, Sessions, it wasn't just that he didn't disclose meeting with Russians. He didn't disclose meeting with any foreign dignitaries, because I think that's an important detail. And also, how is the FBI responding? Because if Sessions, the Justice Department is essentially saying, well, some FBI agent told Sessions he didn't have to do this, do we know is that true?
Well, we asked the FBI for comment, and they have not yet responded. They actually declined to comment. Now, Capitol Hill is also seizing on this report, particularly Democrats, perhaps not surprisingly, jumping on this report, including the top Democrat on the House Judiciary Committee, John Conyers, who says it's time for a thorough investigation into Sessions. And now lawmakers on the House Intelligence Committee had previously said to me that it's possible that Sessions could be questioned about those meetings that he had with the Russian officials during the course of the campaign. And a big question for lawmakers as well that they have about Sessions over is his role over the firing of FBI Director James Comey, even though he recused himself from the Russia investigation. That question was brought directly to Rod Rosenstein, the Deputy Director, Deputy Attorney General, in these closed-door briefings with House members last week. And Anderson, he did not comment about Jeff Sessions' role and suggested that could be a question for Bob Mueller, the special counsel, to look at. So expect those questions to continue going forward, Anderson.
All right, Manu Rajamano, thanks. More now in the larger Russia investigation, the state of play now that a special counsel is part of it. CNN's Jessica Schneider reports on how it's affecting the effort to obtain James Comey's memos of his conversations with the president.
Tonight, lawmakers are waiting for the FBI to turn over memos that fired Director James Comey wrote documenting his meetings with President Trump, including one where the president allegedly told Comey, "I hope you can let this go," referring to the investigation into former National Security Advisor Michael Flynn. The House Oversight and Senate Judiciary Committees demanded that acting FBI Director Andrew McCabe submit any memos or tapes, but neither committee has received them. Meanwhile, Capitol Hill investigations into contact between Trump campaign associates and Russia continue to ramp up. Former Trump campaign manager Paul Manafort just submitted 300 documents to the Senate Intelligence Committee containing drafts of speeches, calendars, and notes from his time with the campaign.
Michael Flynn.
But so far, Michael Flynn isn't cooperating. Flynn plans to invoke his Fifth Amendment rights against self-incrimination and hasn't complied with subpoenas from the Senate and House Intelligence Committees. That refusal has prompted the Senate Intelligence Committee to send two new subpoenas to businesses run by Flynn for records with a May 30th deadline.
If, in fact, there's not a response, we'll seek additional counsel advice on how to proceed forward. At the end of that option is the contempt charge. And I've said that everything is on the table.
While President Trump travels abroad, his legal team is assembling here at home. Mark Kasowitz is expected to lead the team of outside lawyers offering legal counsel amid the Russia probe, according to a senior administration official. Kasowitz has represented Trump for more than 15 years, but he also represents a Russian bank and a Russian business tycoon with ties to Vladimir Putin. Meanwhile, the White House is resetting its search for an FBI director after wide-ranging dissatisfaction with the leading candidate, former Senator Joe Lieberman, all while Paul Ryan put forth a muted defense of fired director James Comey.
You know the former FBI director, Jim Comey. Does it concern you that the president referred to the former FBI director as a nutjob?
Yeah, I don't agree with that, and he's not.
Jessica Schneider joins us now. Do we know if the appointment of Robert Mueller, a special prosecutor, will have any effect on what happens with those memos by Comey?
Well, Anderson, first off, we do know that Mueller has been briefed on these memos from James Comey, but of course they have not been handed over to Congress just yet. House Oversight Chair Jason Chaffetz said today that the FBI contacted his staff and said that the memos would not be handed over today. That was the initial deadline. It's unclear when the memos might be handed over, if at all. And to that end, Senate Judiciary Chair Senator Chuck Grassley has said that he's considering calling a meeting with Robert Mueller along with Senator Dianne Feinstein if the FBI doesn't ultimately hand over those memos. Senator Grassley says he wants to know whether or not Mueller's investigators might actually keep those memos for their own investigation and not ultimately hand them over. Anderson.
Jessica Schneider, Jessica, thank. Next, the panel weighs in. Just ahead, have incidents of the president revealing sensitive intelligence to foreign officials done damage to U.S. relationships with allies? We'll explore that ahead. Before the break, we were talking about Attorney General Jeff Sessions not disclosing contacts with Russia's ambassador during his security clearance vetting. Back with the panel, Jeffrey Toobin, Mark Zaid, Philip Mudd, Steve Hall, and Gloria Borger. Jeff Toobin, I want to ask you about this, but I do want to, you wanted to follow up with something you said in the last hour about the allegations against the Montana campaign candidate for House allegedly assaulting a reporter.
Right. The story broke when we were on the air, and we listened to the audio once, and my reaction was sort of no big deal, don't make a federal case out of it, and I really think I was wrong. I mean, this is a big deal. If the facts are, as the reporter alleged, which is that he asked a perfectly reasonable question, and the response from the candidate was to body slam him, that's a matter for law enforcement, and that's a serious thing, and I regret making light of it. So
on this other story, I mean, the fact that Sessions didn't disclose meetings with the Russian ambassador, we should also point out he is arguing the Department of Justice has some FBI agent told him he didn't need to disclose any meetings with dignitaries in his capacity, and he didn't. It wasn't just the Russians. What do you mean? Is this something?
Well, it is something. I don't know how big a deal it is. He says he got some guidance from the FBI that the form does not mean what the form says. I mean, the form could not be clearer. First of all, it would be interesting to know if he got that guidance. But
right, the FBI is in comment.
Right. The more interesting part of this story is it is yet another example of Sessions and a Trump campaign official not disclosing all of their contacts with the Russian government. That is suspicious, it's important, and there needs to be an explanation why.
Mark, you're a national security attorney. Does it make sense to you that an FBI agent would say to Jeff Sessions, oh, you don't need to do any of that?
Well, it's certainly possible. I mean, there are some agencies that will either limit or expand the scope of what the form requires. And as Jeff said, the Section 20B6 where this would apply can't be clearer, that these meetings with the Russians and other diplomats would have to be reported. But the thing about this is we need more than just this DOJ statement that's been issued. I guarantee you, if this was done in that way, then this is common practice. They're not going to make an exception for Jeff Sessions coming in as a senator to be the attorney general. We have lots of, you know, congressional representatives who go into cabinet positions. They either do it for all or they do it for none. So we should be able to find out if there was something special or unique or really suspicious here.
And we should be able, Steve, to find out if the FBI person actually did say that to Sessions. Richard Painter, the former White House ethics lawyer for George W. Bush, tweeted about this tonight saying, quote, in the Bush administration, someone who lied on a security clearance form would have been out the door within 24 hours. What do you make of this, Steve?
Well, people have
there's a couple. Sorry, Steve. Sorry.
Sorry.
Yeah, there's a couple of things that strike me about this, Anderson. First is, it doesn't ring true to me that you would have, even if there was an FBI officer who said, hey, don't worry about this, this one little bit. You don't have to be as clear as you need to be here. There's all sorts of senior folks, there's senior staffers that a guy like Sessions has that are going to make sure that everything that needs to be on that form is going to be on that form. When I went through reinvestigations myself, or when I had subordinates of mine at CIA who were reapplying for their clearances, occasionally you get a question, geez, do I need to put in every single, you know, person that I've ever met? And my counsel to them was always the same. Look, better safe than sorry. You know, assuming there's nothing to hide here, yeah, get it all out there, because you never want to be in a situation whereby somebody comes back and says, well, wait a minute, were you trying to deceive? Were you purposely leaving stuff out? So it just seems sort of commonsensical that you would, you know, somebody like Sessions would, A, have a staff who would make sure that he gets it right, and secondly, just commonsensically, yeah, you're going to put every contact that you have on there because you don't want to leave yourself open to criticism about this later on.
Gloria, I mean, it seems like there was a lot of confusion from a lot of people, and if confusion is what it is, in Team Trump. I mean, you had Jared Kushner not disclosing, and obviously the issues with Michael Flynn as well.
Right. And you know, with Jared Kushner, it was his clearance form was mistakenly sent in without any listing of foreign officials with whom he met. And we do know that Jared met with a huge number of foreign officials, including Russians, and that his attorney the next day had to amend it. It was apparently sent in by someone from the transition who didn't know much, and then the attorney had to amend it, and they are still in the process of trying to get this list together and meet with the FBI about it. So in the meantime, he has an interim clearance. But, you know, this is a serious thing that people just can't discard. These questions are asked for important reasons, particularly when you're getting a high-level security clearance.
In fact, they're asked for precisely the reason that we're dealing right. with now, which
exactly.
is, did you have contact with a foreign government that was seeking to influence your work?
Right.
And that's what this investigation is about. So the fact that he left it out indicates that, you know, the form was actually an appropriate form. And the other thing that's worth pointing out is that senators, every senator, all 100 senators and all 435 representatives have someone in their office called a scheduler. That's what the person does. And so they have a schedule every day. It's not that difficult to go through the schedules and see how many times he met with the Russian government. And I don't believe it was thousands of people. It was probably several dozen.
Phil, I mean, you've, you know, filled out some forms in your time both at the FBI and the CIA. What do you make of this?
I have a different perspective. Let me give you two pieces of this pie. Number one, I hope I don't get arrested after appearing on AC360. There are a lot of times I didn't declare meetings with foreign officials. This is all about context, Anderson. If I saw somebody for 5 minutes at a Starbucks, for all the people I saw at the FBI and the CIA, especially as I moved up in positions, I was not going to fill out a form every time I passed somebody in the hall in the FBI. British, French, Russian, Chinese. Hey, how you doing? You want to have a cup of coffee? The first measure you have is close and continuing contact. It's not a cup of coffee at Starbucks. The second and final piece of context you have to think about here is we're in an environment on the other side of the spectrum where you have Mike Flynn being fired for an inappropriate contact with Russians and Sessions on Capitol Hill during his hearing saying, I don't remember meeting Russians. You shouldn't and don't have to, in my judgment, declare every five-minute conversation at Starbucks. But this gets a little fuzzy when you say the whole campaign was meeting with these people and repeatedly Attorney General Sessions failed to mention these contexts. That's a little funny.
Right. Well, the context is what counts here. There's a lot of smoke about
yes.
Russians. So how do you not disclose it?
Mark, go ahead, and then we got to go.
I mean, what Phil is saying, the practical reality, there's a lot of substance to that. But I just want to point out, and this is kind of maybe going into the little weeds, there's two questions on the form that this relates to. What Phil's talking about with close and continuing, that's one question. There's another question that deals with whether or not they've had any contact. Any contact. Could be 5 minutes. Now, is that realistic? You know, probably not.
No.
But any contact with foreign government, especially the military service or intelligence. Mm. And as Jeff said, this is why that question is on the
yeah.
form.
Thank you, everybody. Up next, concerned that loose lips in the Trump administration, including the president himself, could sink relationships abroad. We'll talk about that, Ann. Well, Washington pundits like to say that the ship of state is the only vessel that leaks from the top. And these days, the allegation is that this White House leaks from the very top, which would not be unusual, except instead of simply floating trial balloons or planting items in friendly news outlets, this president is accused by critics of handing sensitive information to either friendly or, in some cases, hostile foreign powers. Diane Gallagher has more.
The Trump administration can't seem to keep a secret, and Washington's loose lips could be creating problems with allies abroad. British Home Secretary Amber Rudd expressing anger Wednesday.
The British police have been very clear that they want to control the flow of information in order to protect operational integrity, the element of surprise.
After American security forces leaked the identity of the Manchester Arena attacker.
So it is irritating if it gets released from other sources, and I have been very clear with our friends that that should not happen again.
But it isn't the first time. Just 2 weeks ago, sources reported President Donald Trump shared top secret information with Russian officials in an Oval Office meeting. Former CIA Director John Brennan testified on Tuesday that the president broke protocol in doing this.
It appears as though, at least from the press reports, that neither did it go in the proper channels, nor did the originating agency have the opportunity to clear language for it. So that is a problem.
But said the fact it then became public knowledge was the bigger problem.
That was where the damage came from, I think, that it was released in the press.
But it was the president himself who appeared to accidentally leak that Israel was the source of that sensitive information told to the Russians.
I never mentioned the word or the name Israel. Never mentioned it during that conversation. They were all saying I did. So you had another story wrong.
Except media reports never stated that the president connected it to Israel. Prime Minister Benjamin Netanyahu seemed to take Trump's apparent confirmation in stride. But this morning, when Israel's army radio twice asked the defense minister if Trump's slip-up put the life of an Israeli agent in danger, he would only say, "I will not confirm or deny. We have made a pointed correction. There is unprecedented intelligence cooperation." And leaked to the Washington Post and The Intercept overnight, transcripts from an April 29th phone call between Trump and the Philippines President Rodrigo Duterte that show Trump talking about U.S. nuclear submarines and their location near the Korean Peninsula while calling Kim Jong-un a madman. Intelligence experts say it may seem surprising to the public, but this conversation isn't an issue.
But an element of our diplomacy also is to reassure allies by telling them that help is nearby. So in that particular case, he had a diplomatic message he was sending to the Filipinos, but at the same time, he wasn't giving away the coordinates of that particular submarine, and they're not that easy to find.
That was Diane Gallagher reporting. So given all that, what does it say, if anything, about how this president does business, and how much of a break is this from the way other presidents have traditionally operated? Excuse me. Joining us is retired Navy Rear Admiral John Kirby, who's had an up-close view as a naval officer, former State Department, and Pentagon press secretary, also with us, one of President Reagan's lieutenants, if not admirals. Jeffrey Lord is joining us as well. Admiral Kirby, I mean, there's only two issues here, and they shouldn't be conflated. One is U.S. intelligence sources or law enforcement sources or somebody leaking information about the Manchester investigation. Right. Then there's the president himself disclosing information to the to the Russians in the Oval Office.
Yeah, no, you're right. Those are two separate types of leaks of information. I'm not saying that either one is a good thing, but we do need to make sure that we keep them separate. On the one hand, you do have some, I would suspect, lower-level law enforcement officials putting out information to the press about this ongoing investigation, which could put the investigation at risk and maybe even potentially put lives at risk as they're trying to prosecute the conspirators of this bombing. On the other hand, you do have the president, you know, releasing in a very unscripted, unregulated way, apparently very sensitive intelligence that was shared with us by another nation, and then later announcing to the world what nation that was. And that really could have a chilling effect on intelligence agencies around the world in terms of their decisions to help share and continue to share information with us going forward. Now, I talked to a source in the intelligence community today just to kind of take the temperature on this, and he told me that so far they haven't seen that chilling effect take effect, that other intelligence agencies around the world, while they took notice of this, they're not necessarily making any decisions going forward specifically about sharing intelligence with the United States. However, he did say a common question that they are getting as a result of that Oval Office leak is trying to figure out what the state of the relationship is between the U.S. intelligence community and the White House. They're really more interested in where that relationship is going. And, of course, we know that relationship has already been quite strained.
Yeah. Jeff, I mean, do you think that is what is at the heart of this? I mean, again, not you know, the release of information about the ongoing investigation in Manchester is one thing, and that's one thing that the president and others have talked about, and you have talked about a lot on this program about releasing information right. That shouldn't get out there, and that where are these leaks coming from and they should be stopped.
That's the problem. Let me just start with one lighthearted reference here to, of course, President Reagan. Allies do disagree when the president invaded Grenada, which was, of course, a British Commonwealth state. He didn't tell Margaret Thatcher. She called him. She was very angry. This is recorded, by the way. And he said, he began the conversation by saying, if I were there, Margaret, he was in Washington, she was in London, if I were there, Margaret, I'd throw my hat in the door before I came in. Well, that, of course, immediately melted her a bit, and she was very kind, et cetera, but she was still frosty. My point is allies can have disagreements and get along. That said, this is a bad thing when you've got people in an administration leaking stuff like this. And frankly, I don't care whether it's national security things like this or whether it's some bureaucrat in the EPA or the Justice Department or whomever, wherever it might be. We have elections for a reason. And the bureaucracy, per se, should not be there to undermine the president. If they don't like the president, that's fine, quit. But don't be doing this, because this can have enormous consequences, unintended consequences, and do real damage.
Admiral Kirby, do you see this, what's going on now, as a different situation than has happened in past administrations? Obviously, I mean, this president has criticized the intelligence community early on in a way that it was, you know, at the time kind of considered very surprising, and people warned, you know, you do that, you're going to end up with people who are annoyed and may end up leaking information. But is this a lot different? Because clearly the Obama administration went after leakers more strongly than past administrations.
Sure, they did. They absolutely did. I mean, I've been in Washington too long, I guess. I mean, leaks are just a part of the fabric of everyday life here. And I agree with Jeffrey. Look, there are leaks and then there's leaks. Leaks of classified sensitive information, absolutely against the law, shouldn't be tolerated, and frankly should be investigated and prosecuted. I totally support the administration with respect to that. But this does feel different to me, Anderson, in terms of the speed and the frequency with which leaks are happening under this administration so early on. Yes, President Obama struggled with it. So did President Bush before him. This does feel different. It feels much more aggressive and much more vindictive. Yeah.
All right, Admiral Kirby, Jeffrey Lord, thank you both very much. Coming up, the latest from Manchester, where there have been new raids and arrests following the deadly bombing. Four of the 22 people killed in the Manchester bombing have been identified tonight. One we do not have a picture of. Her name is Jane Tweddle, a mother of three. Also confirmed by their families and schools to have died in the attack is 29-year-old Martin Hett, Marson and Angelica Kliss, Nell Jones, a teenage student, and Michelle Kiss, also a mother of three. And we're just getting word tonight of another young couple confirmed to be among the victims, 17-year-old Chloe Rutherford and 19-year-old Liam Curry. In a statement, their families say they were inseparable, that they wanted to be together forever, and now they are. There have been a number of new raids and arrests in the case, including the brother of the suspected bomber in Libya. He was arrested on suspicion of links to ISIS. His older brother, the Manchester bombing suspect, also had been in Libya for 3 weeks. Returned to England days before the attack, according to U.S. military officials. Also new tonight, these pictures published in the New York Times reportedly showing what could be parts of the device that was used, the explosive device that was used, fragments even of a backpack used in the bombing. The photos appear to have been taken by British authorities. CNN asked the Greater Manchester Police about the photographs. They had no comment. Our senior international correspondent, Clarissa Ward, is in Manchester. She joins us now. What is the latest on the arrest, Clarissa?
So, Anderson, what we know is that there have been a series of raids taking place across Manchester today. Altogether now, seven people have been arrested as authorities continue the work of really trying to drill down on whether there is indeed a larger network or ISIS cell potentially still active here in the United Kingdom. Now, you mentioned we're getting some interesting information from Libya, from a militia in Libya. We can't obviously confirm their claims, but they claim to have arrested the brother of the suicide bomber. They say that he was planning an attack, a terror attack, for the city of Tripoli, which is the capital of Libya. They said that under interrogation, he actually confessed that he and his brother were both members of ISIS. I should stress again, Anderson, that obviously we can't confirm these claims, but it is interesting. We're seeing the net start to widen from the UK, also now possibly to Libya. And just on the topic, Anderson, of those photographs published by the New York Times, while the Manchester police neglected to make any comment, or rather they said, we will not make any comment on this, British counterterrorism police have not been so circumspect. They have said that it is damaging to the relationship that exists between intelligence sharing powers, that it undermines the investigation. And this comes on the heels of Britain's Home Secretary, which is the equivalent of the Homeland Secretary, saying this morning that leaks coming from U.S. officials to the media have been, quote, irritating, Anderson.
We should also point out, I mean, when people think about ISIS, they think about Syria, they think about Iraq, but there is a very large and dangerous presence in Libya as well.
There is a very dangerous presence in Libya, and ISIS has been fighting a battle against a U.S.-led coalition from the air and also various militias and factions on the ground that have been fighting against ISIS, particularly in the stronghold of Sirte. And they've been quite effectively pushed back, Anderson. But what you realize is that in a country like Libya, which is still relatively lawless and chaotic, it's still very easy for smaller cells to form under the radar, and you see how able they are to plan or choreograph these kinds of attacks. I think that's one thing officials here really want to get to grips with. Was the attack planned in Libya or was it planned here? Is the bomb maker, well, potentially the suicide bomber himself, or was it someone in Libya or was it someone here? These are the kinds of questions that will be crucial to answer as British authorities try to work out if potentially there could be a bomb maker or a larger network still here in the United Kingdom, Anderson.
Crystal Ball, Clarissa, thanks very much. Just ahead, the impression Melania Trump is making on her 5-city, 9-day journey overseas and the reception she's getting on the world stage. President Trump has one more stop on his overseas trip. He's in Brussels tonight. Tomorrow, from there, it's on to Sicily. It's his first foreign trip, obviously, as president, and the first time that Melania Trump, a native of Slovenia, has traveled overseas as first lady. She's making quite an impression. Kate Bennett tonight has more.
With a donor for the heart transplant he needs, Melania tweeting the news. The trip has been the most the world has seen of the first lady in...
Kate, we've seen Melania Trump at every stop, but are we going to hear from her at all on this trip?
We're expected to. At the last stop in Sicily, she's planning on speaking to a group of U.S. military members and their families. It'll be the first time that she's given a professional speech on this trip. Otherwise, she's been relatively quiet.
Kate Bennett, thanks very much for the reporting. We'll be right back.